What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. In one of Geekific's very first videos, we discussed generics and wildcards. Today we're going to expand further on this topic by tackling the difference when and why we should use the simple generic type, the non-bounded wildcard, the upper bounded wildcard, and the lower bounded wildcard. Let's start with a very simple example, and suppose we have this doStuff method. You see, this method takes in an array of objects as a parameter and does stuff with this array. Now, consider this array of strings. Are we able to pass this array to the method we just wrote? Yes, we can. Array of string is a subtype of array of objects. But now, suppose this method takes in a list of objects instead of array, and we want to pass in a list of strings. Can we do that? No, we can't, because collection types and generics in Java are invariant. Now, before we tackle what this means, let me tell you that the error we got is actually a good thing. Imagine we decided to store integers in the array of strings we passed as parameter to the method that takes in an array of objects. What would have happened? Our code would have compiled with no errors, but we would have got a runtime exception. So making collections and generics invariant shifted our errors and exceptions from runtime to compile time, and that is one hell of a benefit. So what does invariance mean? And if collections are invariant, what about arrays? Well, there are three main terms you should be aware of: covariance, contravariance, and invariance. Covariance means that if we have a type T, only type T and subtypes of T are allowed in this context. In Java, this is represented by the upper bounded wildcard, and by nature arrays in Java are covariant, hence why we were able to pass in the array of strings in our very first method. On the other hand, contravariance means that if we have a type T, only type T and supertypes of T are allowed in this context, and this is represented by the lower bounded wildcard in Java. Finally, invariance means that if we have a type T, only type T is allowed in this context. No supertypes or subtypes of T are allowed. Now, based on our previous examples, some may say that arrays provide us with more flexibility, but collections provide us with more compile time safety. So, which one should we pick? Well, you don't have to choose, because by making use of bounded wildcards, we get the flexibility back, all while maintaining the compile time safety. Okay, now that we answered why we should make use of wildcards, let's try and answer when should we make use of each one of them. Suppose that you have a method that calculates the sum of numbers in a collection, as you can see in front of you. Now, as we previously established, collections are invariant. So, if we try to pass in to the method a list of integers or doubles, let's say, our code will not compile. In this case, the extends wildcard is the answer. As you can see, the compiler is now happy and allows us to pass a collection of a subtype of number, leading to the output in front of you. However, there is something you need to keep in mind while using this upper bounded wildcard. If, at some point, we decide we want to add elements to the collection declared with the extends wildcard, well, we can't do that. So, if we attempt to add an element like this, the compiler will throw an error. Otherwise, we could add a double number to a collection, which is designed to accept only integer numbers. The only thing we can add into such a list is null, as it belongs to every reference type. Now, before moving on to the super wildcard, remember that we made use of the extends wildcard in this example because we were retrieving the elements from the collection to sum them up, and we weren't trying to alter the collection by adding elements to it. We'll need that later. Okay, now suppose that you have the following method that adds the integer numbers from 1 to 5 into a past collection, as you can see in front of you. Additionally, we have a list of numbers in which we want to add these integers. The method we wrote accepts a collection of integers, and hence it's illegal to pass a list of numbers to it. And here the extends wildcard cannot be used like this, because number is supertype of integer and not a subtype. In this case, the super wildcard is the solution. After updating the signature of our method, it is now legal to pass to it our list of numbers. The compiler is happy, leading to the output of the code snippet you see. With a super wildcard, we can also pass a list of objects like this. However, there is a catch. If we wanted to retrieve the sum of the elements inside the collection declared with the super wildcard, we won't be able to do that, and the code snippet we just gave is proof. The compiler cannot execute the sum operation, for example, on a list storing integers and strings at the same time. So in this example, we made use of the super wildcard because we needed to add elements into the collection. We needed to alter our list, and we weren't trying to retrieve these elements from that list. The examples we gave, and my emphasis on when we needed to add or retrieve elements from the bounded collection, was to lead to a mnemonic for wildcard usage, and it goes by PECS. Producer extends, consumer super. So, if T is a producer, which means when we are passing in a parameter from which we are producing T's, we want to get T's out of this parameter. Then we should use the type ?extends T. Whereas if T is a consumer, which means when we are passing in a parameter into which we want to put T's, the thing consumes elements of type T. Then we should use the type ?superT. In short, use extends when you only want to get values out of a structure, use super when you only put values into a structure, and don't use a wildcard when you both get and put. Now, what I just said can be represented by the small table you see in front of you. So, if we are producing and consuming T's, it means that the object we are dealing with is invariant in T, we can only work with T's, not its subtype nor its supertypes. If we are only producing T's, it means that the object we are dealing with is covariant in T, and we should make use of ?extends T. If we are only consuming T's, it means that the object we are dealing with is contravariant in T, and we should make use of ?super T. Finally, if we aren't producing nor consuming T's, it means that the object we are dealing with is independent of T, and hence we should make use of unbounded wildcards. Okay, before ending this video, the last thing I want to talk about are return types. You may have noticed that in all of the examples we gave, bounded wildcards were only being used as method parameters, never as method outputs. Why is that? Well, why do we use wildcards? We use them to make our APIs and methods more flexible. Our methods should just work. Clients making use of these methods or a particular library shouldn't have to think about wildcards or about passing in the exact parameter type. But what happens if we return wildcards? Well, the people making use of our library will have to create a variable of the wildcard type to store in the return value, and this will strip the clients of the flexibility we previously granted as we just made it more difficult to use. Let us know in the comments below if you'd like to see more videos about generics and wildcards in Java. And that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.